The series of sermons that Brother Glenn's been preaching, Sound the Alarm, have an special importance in our day and time. I am so thankful that we are in a church that's willing to preach this warning. I'll tell you what God has to say about it. In Ezekiel chapter 33, we find these words. The word of the Lord came to me, Son of man, speak to your people and tell them, suppose I bring the sword against the land, and the people of the land select a man from among them, appointing him as their watchman. And he sees the sword coming against the land and blows the trumpet to warn the people. Then, if anyone hears the sound of the trumpet but ignores the warning, and the sword comes and takes him away, his blood will be on his own head. Since he heard the sound of the trumpet but ignored the warning, his blood is on his own hands. If he had taken the warning, he would have saved his life. However, if the watchman sees the sword coming but doesn't blow the trumpet so that the people aren't warned and the sword comes and takes away their lives, then they have taken away because of their iniquity. But I will hold the watchman accountable for their blood. Pray with me. Father, I want to thank you this morning. Father, for a pastor that will stand and warn a church. Father, in the difficult times that we're living, understanding what's happening around us. Father, there are many times that we back up and say, what in the world is happening? And Father, as Ann Graham Lotz puts it, Father, when people see that things in the world we live in are just falling apart, Father, she says she sees things falling in place. God, I pray for Brother Glenn this morning. Father, as he sounds the alarm once again, Father, I pray that you would bless him. Father, protect him. Father, I pray that he would preach this morning in boldness like we've not heard. Father, we live in desperate times. We need a desperate word for you. Father, bless him as he speaks to us this morning. For it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Sounds, and we hear the song God Bless America. It was tempting today to pull out some kind of patriotic sermon, but I don't believe that's where we need to go. When I think of the idea of God Bless America, and this year in particular, as we pray for that and we want God to bless America, and I believe God has blessed America, but then I hear the words echoing of our president as he talked to made that phone call to one of the individuals that filed suit and that ended up getting the Supreme Court decision that we had, and he ended his conversation with God bless you. Folks, that situation, just like America, is in danger of losing God's blessing because God will not bless sin. And here's the deal. If America is going to change, and if America is going to turn back to God, it's not going to be because of the White House, or the Congress, or the Republicans, or the Democrats, or the Independents. It's going to be because the Church of God starts being the Church of God again. And so what I think we need to hear today is not patriotism, but it's a call for the church to return. And it just fits right in with the series. We have looked at four calls to return, and today the call to return is a call to return to unity, and we'll be in Acts chapter 4 in just a few moments. You know, I grew up in church. I don't remember a time in my life that I didn't go to church. Before I had anything to say about it, my parents carried me to church. By the time I thought I had something to say about it, my parents took me to church. There was never an option on Sunday morning. There was never a discussion, what are we going to do today? We're going to church. There was never a discussion on Wednesday nights about what we were going to do. We were going to church. And not only did we go to church, but we were actively involved in church. My dad was a deacon. I can't remember when he was ordained, so I was evidently young enough that, you know, I didn't understand what all was going on. But we've been involved, and when you're in the family of someone that is leading the church, you kind of know the back door of the church type stuff, you know? You know, everything's not just as rosy as we make it seem on Sunday morning when we walk in and go, hey, great to see you. I got to thinking back, I have been a member of, I believe it's 11 churches, and that I was saved, no, I'm sorry, of 9 churches. I was saved when I was 11. You say, boy, you jumped churches. No, I've moved several times. But out of the 49 years of my salvation and being involved in churches, 21 of them have been in 2 churches. So it's not a lot of church, there's no church hopping there, okay? But as I've been involved in church, either being the son of a deacon or being in volunteer leadership roles, or now for 21 years being in ministerial pastoral roles, what I have found is when you say church unity, it's often an oxymoron statement. Because church unity is not as prevalent as we would like for it to be, and I think as God wants it to be. I've seen more than my share of church fusses and church fights and church power struggles. So today we're calling the alarm to the church, not just First Baptist Church in Iowa Park, but the churches, to return to unity. Unity is defined in Webster a couple of ways. One is a combination of ordering of parts in a literary or an artistic production that constitutes a whole or produces an undivided total effect. Now, I almost left that one out. I thought, well, that doesn't apply to the church. But then I got to thinking, the great creator, the one that is the supreme creator that created the world, God, not only created the world and everything in it, but he instituted the second institution. Marriage was first and the church was second. And so if God created it, is it not an artistic work? Isn't he more artistic than anyone on this earth? He put together in such a way this group that he calls, this body that he called the church, and he put us together, and we're so different. Yet we are unified. Or at least in his design, we are to be unified. Another definition says a totality of related parts, an entity that is a complex or systematic whole. Another beautiful description of what the church should be. So with those definitions in mind, we're going to think about the church. We're going to think about God's masterpiece. He said, this is my bride. What is unity? A year ago, we went through a study, and there was one of those chapters was on unity, and someone asked that question, does that mean we all agree? And absolutely not. There are times that we disagree. But I think it means that we disagree while we're agreeable. Okay? And you say, well, what does it look like? Well, I hope what you're seeing in our church staff is an illustration of that. That has been one of my goals as a senior pastor, is to have a staff that demonstrates unity. Someone said one time, well, just can't get into that group. Well, thank you. Now, and by that I mean I don't want us to be untouchable, but here's what I do want. I want us to be able to trust each other. I want us to be able to confide in each other as a staff. I want us that when we walk out of that office, we walk out as one unit to lead God's church. Now, does that mean we don't disagree? No, we disagree. Does that mean that as senior pastor, I haven't gone to some of the staff members and individually said, hey, here's a problem and this needs to change? No, I've done that. But let me tell you the other thing I've done. I've asked each and every one of them to do the same thing to me. If you see something, you hear something, and you come to me and say, Brother Glenn, or Glenn, we're struggling with what you said. We're struggling with what you're doing. That should be the safe place where we come together as a team and do that. One of the most beautiful pictures I saw of it was just recently when I heard one staff member talking to another staff member, and they said, you know what you said the other day in staff meeting about this certain thing? The more I thought about it and prayed about it, I think you're off base. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. I thought the same thing. But I just decided instead of confronting it there to give it some time and see what would happen, and in a matter of a day, there was this taking place in the office. And a few hours later, this individual came to me and said, so-and-so said, did you hear that? And I said, yeah. Well, you didn't get up and say anything. And I said, didn't need to. And they said, well, what do you think? And I said, they were right. And so adjustments were made. But when we left, see, you didn't know any of that was going on. See, that's unity. That's unity working where we work together. And what the people see is a unified staff. It can work the same way in the church. Let me tell you another way it works. If someone comes to me and says, Glenn, I got a problem with Josh, one of my first things will be, have you talked to Josh? And if not, let's get him in here and talk about it. Because see, divide and conquer works with children and parents. It works with staff, and it works with the church. We are to be unified. And one of the prettiest, beautiful pictures of that is in Acts chapter 4. Acts chapter 4, beginning with verse 31. It says, when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak God's message with boldness. Now the multitude of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one said that any of his possessions was his own, but instead they held everything in common, and the great power of the apostles were giving testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was on all of them. For there was not a needy person among them, because all those who owned land or houses sold them, brought the proceeds of things that were sold, and laid them at the apostles' feet. And this was distributed to each person as anyone had a need. Joseph, a Levite, a Cypriote by birth, whom the apostles named Barnabas, which is translated son of encouragement, sold a field he owned and brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. So we see this taking place in the early church. But before we look at exactly what was going on, I think we need to back up and look at what was taking place before these things took place. And it was prayer. There was a key prayer that set the stage for everything else. In the passage in Acts, we need to understand that this was dealing with a church that was young, a church that was trying to get its legs, a church that was trying to figure out how it worked in this world after the death and resurrection of Christ, and it was also a church that was in the midst of persecution. They were already being persecuted. Sometimes we think persecution just started. Folks, it's been going on since the church existed. And so as we look at what happened here, if we had backed up, and we won't take time to read it, but Peter and John had brought healing to a lame man at the temple gate. And it upset the Jews. And so, because as they healed this man, a crowd gathered around. That will always happen when miracles take place, and this crowd gathers around, and Peter and John begin to preach in the name of Jesus. They were arrested. Acts chapter 4, verse 2 says, "For teaching the people and proclaiming in the person of Jesus the resurrection from the dead." In verse 18 of chapter 4, they were ordered not to preach or to teach at all in the name of Jesus. They were threatened again and then released. I thought as I read this, the more things change, the more they're the same. Folks, that's the problem. It was the name of Jesus that got our students confronted in the temple, the Mormon temple. It's the name of Jesus. People, the world is not concerned about religion. They're okay with religion. Larry and I were talking this morning. There's a church of the cannabis. These are guys that are smoking the wacky weed, and they've got their own church now, and they're giving testimony of how wonderful it is. Well, that's making marijuana the god. So nobody has a problem with that. Or most people don't. The world doesn't. The world doesn't have a problem. The guy down in Oklahoma City that wants the satanic worship, this church of Satan, religion of all weird kinds is popping up everywhere. The problem is not religion. The problem the world has is with Jesus Christ and the presentation of his name and his way. But the place we're sitting is we are the ones charged with proclaiming his name. More things change, the more they're the same. As persecution increases, there's a great need to return to unity. A divided church will never make a mark on this culture. I believe that the scripture shows us that the prayer was key to the unity of the church. I want you to look back at verses 23 through 30, just prior to what we read a moment ago, chapter 4 of Acts. After they were released, this is Peter and John, after they were released, they went to their own fellowship, into their own church, and they reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. When they heard this, the group, they raised their voices to God unanimously and said, "Master, you are the one." Sorry, the air conditioning is working good this morning. "You are the one who made the heaven and the earth and the sea and everything in them. And you said through the Holy Spirit by the mouth of our father David, your servant, why did the Gentiles rage and the peoples plot futile things? The kings of the earth took their stand and the rulers assembled together against the Lord and against his Messiah. For in fact, in this city, both Herod and Pontius Pilate with the Gentiles and the peoples of Israel assembled together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, to do whatever your hand and your plan had predestined to take place. And now, Lord, consider their threats and grant your slave that your slaves may speak your message with complete boldness, while you stretch out your hand for the healing, signs, and wonders to perform through the name of your holy servant, Jesus." And that is when the place shook, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit. An interesting prayer in the face of persecution. There was no praying, "Lord, protect us. Lord, give us safety." That never entered their minds. Their prayer was for an increased boldness to speak the message of Christ Jesus. "Lord, don't hide us. Shine your light on us. Lord, don't make it where no one's offended, we're not offending people. Lord, give us boldness to give the name of Jesus in the face of people telling us to not do it." Now let me tell you, when you start praying that in the face of persecution, there's going to be some unity because you're going to have to move together under the power of God. But I read what they were praying, and then I look back and see, and this echoes the words of Peter and John in their response to the Sanhedrin. They're standing before the Sanhedrin. They're being persecuted, being questioned, being told what to do and what not to do. And then in Acts chapter 4, verses 19 and 20, listen to what they said. whether it's right in the sight of God for us to listen to you rather than God, you decide. For we are unable to stop speaking about what we have seen and heard. They didn't say we're choosing to speak about what we've seen and heard. They said we're unable to do anything else. We can't. We have no choice in the matter. We're unable to do anything else. That needs to be our attitude in this world today. Because the world is going to tell us, and the government's going to tell us, and all these special interest groups are going to tell us, you need to modify your message. You need to tone it down. You need to adjust it so it fits the culture. And what Peter and John was saying is what we need to be saying is that whether we follow God or we follow you, you figure out all that stuff. We're just telling you, we've got to say what we've got to say. We've got to preach what we've got to preach because God has given us one job, one direction, and we don't get to choose anything else. We must. We are unable to stop speaking about what we've seen and what we've heard. The church as a whole was so focused on their call, so focused on their responsibility, that everything else became secondary. But there's more. They were not only focused on that, they were focused on the fact that they were of what they were to do primarily, but also at the same time, they realized that they were totally dependent upon God. And we've got to understand the same thing. In verse 30, they said, while you, talking to God, while you stretch out your hand for healing, signs and wonders to be performed through the name of your holy servant Jesus. God, we're going to do what we're called to do. We have no choice but to be faithful to you and do what you've told us to do. But God, we need you to do what only you can do. And let me tell you, when we get to that place, God will come through with his part every time. It is time that the world sees the power of the church working through the power of God through the person of Jesus Christ. God hasn't changed. God's the same God. The problem is we've backed off and tried to find a better, more palatable way to do it. And there's not one. Focused prayer leads to focused living. See, their actions spoke volumes about their unified commitment. Not only the fact that they prayed together, but the way they prayed together brought them to the place where they were, united in heart, the Bible says, and united in mind. Notice it wasn't just the leaders in verse 32, but it was the multitude who had come together and who believed. Those who believed. In other words, the church, the believers in the church came together, and they were all together in unity, in focus, unity in prayer, and it was fleshed out through unity in action. See, the prayer had some theological implications and some motivational implications. One commentator points out that the prayer began with the theme of creation and went to Revelation and then incarnation, which all those are important doctrines, but let me tell you, isn't that what we've talked about if we're going to deal with the issues that are on the table today of same-sex marriage and all of those things? We've got to start with creation. We've got to go back to Genesis and say, this is the way God created it to be. We've got to take them right on through and say, okay, this was the creation. Now here's revelation, and I'm not talking about revelations. You can show them that too. But God has revealed through his church what marriage is to be. God has revealed in Ephesians how marriage was supposed to look. And for all these folks to say, well, Jesus never talked about it. He didn't use the word homosexuality. He didn't. What he did is he said, here's what marriage is. Here's the real thing. Anything that doesn't look like this is wrong. Took care of it, I think. And then we can go all the way to the book of Revelation, and we see when in that is as God shows what takes place in the end time and how Jesus brings his bride, the church, to himself. But then the prayer turned to dealing with life and its daily problems, because what they understood is that stuff is real to God too, just like it's real to us. They said, you can have all these theological things and you can answer all the questions right, but then it comes to living it out and what it looks like, and we need God's help in that also. They understood that everything rested in the power of God. See, as I've tried to evaluate where churches are today and what's going on with the church and what we need to do, I came to a statement, and I'll be honest, it just hit me this morning as we were praying, and I told Larry what it was, and I wrote it down. We need to quit trying to fix the church. And we need to just start being the church. Isn't that what's been happening over the years? We've tried to fix the church. Jesus said, here's what it's supposed to look like. God has given us the formula, and we've tried to make it fit everything that we've gone along. Let's quit trying to fix it. If God created it, and he put it together, he did it right, it doesn't need fixing. Let's just be the church that God's called us to be. And he's got the formula right here in his word. We need to quit trying to fix something that, if we go back to God's design, isn't broken. Now, please understand that in this text, as it talks about selling everything and sharing everything, this isn't some hippie commune. Okay? This isn't, we're all going to have our little flowers and we're going to live happily. It's not that. That's not even the point here. When people do that with this passage, what they're doing is pulling it totally out of context. See, there are principles we need to learn here, but this is the only place, I think, maybe one other place in Scripture where it really talks about doing it this particular way. So we draw principles. We don't do universal application. And so it's not saying that you're not supposed to own property and I'm not supposed to own property and that we ought to all sell it and give it to the church and split it. That's just the way it fleshed out here. Okay? It's not saying that this is exactly the way we're supposed to do it. There were no laws enacted here. There was nothing forced, but they were unified. See, when we're unified, legalese is no big deal. We push that aside. Legalism raises its head when unity's not there. Now, if you look past this and you go into verse 5, chapter 5, and we're not going to, but if you do that, you run across a couple by the name of Ananias and Sapphira. Things got tough for them, didn't it? They didn't share in this stuff, and God killed them. Was the problem that they didn't sell all their property? Is that why God killed them? Not at all. The problem was they lied about it. The problem was the sin of lying about it. He never said you had to do it, but they came in, they said, this is what we've done, we've done everything, and they hadn't. Well, why did God take that so serious? Let me tell you, lying will divide the church. It has to be truth, folks. And you can call it little white lie or big black lie. Lying will bring division to the body and break the unity every time. So it wasn't so much about the property as it was about the heart and the mindset and the direction of the people saying, we're going to do whatever it takes to be together because there's a bigger message. There's something greater than the things we have. You see, the unity was visible through their unselfish acts. When we have unity, it will be seen through our activity. I think this gives one of the clearest views of Christians and possessions. I think what it teaches here is that the point is not ownership, but stewardship. I think what it teaches here is that it's not about a creed, it's about a need. It teaches it's not about a fad, but it's about family. And you say, wait a minute, we're talking the church. Absolutely. Let me explain something to you if you don't know it. The blood of Jesus is thicker than the blood of ancestry. There are some of you that are sitting here today can say, I can attest to that, because there have been things that I've gone through that my church family has stuck closer to me than my blood family. It is about the body being the body of Christ. So how does a group of people who are all so different ever get to a true place of unity? How do they get to the place where they can truly, honestly proclaim, it's not mine, it's not yours, it's not even ours? See, they came to this place because they really understood who the owner was. Back in verse 33, we find the phrase, and great grace was on all of them. They could look at those in need, and without pointing a finger of condemnation, they could say, but by the grace of God go I. This morning, after I had gone through the sermon and was studying it again, and my normal Sunday morning routine is to get up and study and pray, and then I have to eat 3 times a day. And so fix me something to eat, get a cup of coffee, and then I turn on television and watch James Merritt. I love his preaching. And he's preaching a series through the parables. And today, as he was preaching, he was talking about the Pharisee and the tax collector. And it hit me, sometimes our statement of "there but the grace of God go I" is a great religious phrase that we kind of toss on things, but we're really not saying that. In our hearts, what we're saying is, I'm not like you, and I don't have the problem you have, and I'm better than you are. And see, we start looking at I instead of God. I've done better at this. I'm better at that. You've blown it there. And folks, that is what was taking place with the Pharisee when he was looking at the tax collector. Oh, they were standing in the same temple, but it had nothing to do with God from his perspective. It had to do with what he thought he was such a good, great thing for God. It was all about himself and nothing about God. And we can't throw religious phrases on top of stuff and a scripture or two on top of stuff and really be godly. See, what the tax collector did was said, Lord, I don't deserve anything. Lord, have mercy on me. And isn't it interesting that the one that thought he had it all together was basing it on totally the wrong thing? And the Bible says he went away rejected by God. But the one who said, God, just have mercy on me, and he recognized he was a sinner, he's the one that God said is the right one. And so we've got to get to the place where we stop looking at other people. Because see, if we're going to minister to a world that's hurting and broken, we're going to have to do it in unity as a church. But we're also going to have to quit pointing condemning fingers at them. Have they blown it? Yes. Have you and I blown it many times? Absolutely. We're all sinners. Their sin is no different from ours. Well, yeah, it is. I wouldn't do that. Yeah, but you'd do something they haven't done. And God sees it all the same. Unity of the church is saying we're all sinners and we don't have anything other than the grace and the mercy of God. And it's amazing when you look at the mercy of God, guess what? By definition, it's something none of us deserve. It is Him having mercy, not giving us what we deserve. And His grace is giving us what we don't deserve. So without God's mercy and grace, we're all doomed. Folks, there's a world hurting out there. And the church is still trying to figure out what we want to do for ourselves. We need our focus. And you say, well, do you still need to do business? Absolutely. But when our focus is in the right place, everything else comes together. We've got to quit looking inside and start looking outside. That's what they were saying. Lord, it's a mess out there, but give us boldness to be your voices. Give us boldness to move out into our world and into our community and take a stand for you. Were there still details to be worked out? Just read the book of Acts. There was a lot of details to be worked out in the church. And it's dealt with, but it's dealt with in focus. They put the big thing, and everything else became small things. And you know what I have found that in the church over the years is when we're all working for the big thing, we'll agree on the little things because they don't become a big deal. We're stewards. They realized that they were stewards of all that they had, not owners. The owner is the same guy that's the owner today, God Himself. And by His grace, we have what we have, period. 1 Corinthians 6, 19 and 20 says, don't you know that your body is a sanctuary of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God? You're not your own, for you're bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body. Well, if it applies to your body, does it not apply to everything you've got? If it applies to my body, does it not apply to everything I've got? I'm a steward. God has so lavished His grace on us. Do we dare be selfish with anything? We're supposed to help them. I mean, if they just keep a job, we wouldn't need to help them. Okay? I mean, even inside the church, folks, one of the most difficult places, if you've been one of those people that have had the fortune in your life and God's blessing on your life so that you're able to do for others, and then suddenly because of illness, maybe you're sick, and you're not able to physically do anymore, and you're dependent on somebody else. We're going through that with my mother-in-law right now. She's always been the one doing and taking care of people, and now suddenly she can't take care of herself, much less other people, and she doesn't know what to do with it. One of the toughest places to be is to say, I can't do it. I can't do it anymore. I need help. Some of you understand that. You're having to admit that, you know, the knees just don't work anymore. The back doesn't handle it anymore. The strength just isn't there. And you're having to depend on other people. And those of you that are in that place understand that that's a hard place to be. But see, that's when the body comes together and says, we're going to be there. We're going to be together. I think it was Kim that said last year while we were on that roof of that lady's house in Utah and all those Mormons were watching around us, we were on the second floor up on top of that house and it was hot. And he said, but think of the testimony. Because they pride themselves in the fact of taking care of each other, but here's the church of Jesus Christ. God's church, the church that holds to the true scripture, and we're up here doing this for people that we've never met before. It's the church being the church. And so what they saw was a unity in a body that in that case wasn't even a local body. It was some people from the place called Iowa Park that none of them, well, Dennis, we did find somebody last year in Utah that was from Iowa Park, didn't we? So you never know. Be careful what you do. But, you know, they'd never heard of Iowa Park. But here were these people coming and working and helping other believers. So not only does it work inside the church, because if we'll get it right inside the church, it'll work in the church as a whole, where it's across not just your church or my church, but our churches, God's churches working together. And that's what was taking place there. We need to have an attitude of gratitude and unselfishness and grace that will keep things from becoming so personal with us. You say, well, what does that mean? I mean, it means quit getting your feelings hurt. If I recognize that nothing is mine, then what am I bowing up for? It's God's. Let's let Him work on it. Let Him take care of it. He'll bring us together. But we've got, I guess this is okay, even though it's being recorded. But, you know, that's what we've had to do in our family with Jerry's mom. Communication's tough. And it's hard. And so if we're not careful, she's got five brothers and sisters, and so there's six kids, and you throw the outlaws in, and then you really got a mess. And we had to stop and say, time out. We're together here. We're on the same team. Yeah, we're all doing the best we can do, but we've got to work together because the task is important. And so what we had to do is say, you know what? We know everyone's under stress, and there are times that you're going to say things that I've just got to quit taking it personal. And just say, okay. And understand that you're under stress and I'm under stress. When things don't go our way, we can't start blaming other people. Ben Carson, Dr. Ben Carson's mother is not a theologian. You'll see in a moment, but according to Dr. Carson, his mom had a poem that she made her boys memorize. And anytime they were in trouble, they had to quote it. It's a poem by Mamie White Miller entitled, "Yourself to Blame." It says, if things go bad for you and make you a bit ashamed, often you will find out that you have yourself to blame. Swiftly we ran to mischief, and then bad luck came. Why do we fault others? We have ourselves to blame. Whatever happens to us, here's what we say. If it had not been for so-and-so, things wouldn't have gone that way. If you're short of friends, I'll tell you what to do. Make an examination. You'll find the faults in you. You're the captain of your ship, so agree with the same. If you travel downward, you have yourself to blame. Now, obviously, if theologically you look at that, folks, I'm not the captain of my ship, and you're not the captain of your ship, God is, okay? But you get her point. I know some folks that have jumped church after church after church, and their response is, well, that church over there has got all those people, and they're just a bunch of hypocrites. That church over there, they're just wrong. They do things wrong. After you've done that a time or two, maybe you ought to look in the mirror and say, I'm the problem. I'm the problem. You hear people say, well, I just don't have any friends. No one's friendly to me. My question is, are you friendly to them? Sometimes the reason we don't have people is because we are the one repelling them, but we think we're right. And the church has done it as a church over and over and over again by being judgmental. You say, do we overlook sin? Absolutely not. But we deal with the sin and we love the sinner. And that's whether it's in our own body or those outside the church. As the world spirals faster and faster and deeper into chaos, folks, we need to see it as a prime opportunity. I don't believe it's going to be long before the Lord returns, which means we don't have a lot of time to take people with us. And there's plenty of room in heaven for everyone that will go. And we need to be about the task of boldly speaking the name of Jesus Christ. The world desperately needs to hear it. Even in all this stuff, let me tell you, these people that are celebrating right now thinking they have found the answer to life are grabbing hold of a lie that is going to leave them empty and broken and hurting. We have the answer, and it's not the Baptist answer. It's not the First Baptist Church of Iowa Park answer. It is the answer of Jesus Christ. But we need to unify and follow Him and be ready and looking for those that are hurting and saying, let us share with you. This is not, I mean, God is still the judge. He's still in control. And we're His people. We're the ones here on earth to represent Him and to share Him. And we need to be ready. Which means we need to be unified so that as we move more into persecution, we're together saying it's us. And we're standing with Christ and we love you and we have the answer. Now, you might not look like us in some cases. You might not seem that you've got everything together, but we must admit we don't either. But we have Jesus. And He died for everyone. 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 Even those we don't agree with. How do you get the mindset of unity? You look at the bigger picture, and it's an eternal picture. And it makes the time here seem so short. When you think of what eternity is, what's the blip on this screen? Yes, we got to live in this world, and we've got to do those things that we have to do in this world, but we need to get a bigger view that this is about the kingdom of God. No one's interested in listening to a church that is not unified following Christ. It is time that we hear the alarm and respond. It is time for us to return to God. It is time for us to return to our first love, Jesus Christ. It is time for us to return to prayer. It is time for us to return to God's Word. It is time for us to return to unity.